I don't think I'm going to answer all the questions. I will. Some questions are related. For instance, the questions of, are we ready to farm? Okay, the land question, firstly, we don't demand our land because necessarily there's something that we're going to do with it. Let's start with the first question. We want our land back because it belongs to us. Yeah. I think it's a very, because you see, those who stole our land keep on throwing that question at us, but I agree, we must discuss amongst ourselves a tenure system, economic system, but we must not get detained by this question. Do you have a plan for land? You see, we must treat it like this. A guy steals your car, you meet them in the street, they have now made it look better, they're making a business with it. Now you want your car back and they ask you, do you have a plan for this car? So we must sort out the first question first. The land belongs to us. It must be returned. What we do with it is a secondary question. It is in fact our business. Because but it is true, we as revolutionaries must then answer the question, how is the land, how will the land be held? For instance, BLF do not accept the proposition that the state must own the land. Yes. The land belongs to the people. The state must protect our ownership of the land. You give the land to the state. Imagine. Because the state is managed by politicians. Politicians are going to own the land and we are going to become their tenants. In Nigeria, I hope you know Nigeria, that oil is nationalized in Nigeria. Nigeria is in the top 10 of oil producers in the world, I think, if not top 15. The people of Nigeria pay one of the highest, for petrol. They suffer. Why? The politicians have nationalized oil to themselves. Any politician that says the land belongs to the state, that person means we must come and recover beggar lefatshe la rona ka gonne tla be le bona ba tshwere lefatshe la rona. The land belongs to the people. The state guarantees our right to that land. The land does not belong to the state. We cannot be going around asking the state to give us back our land. Which state? This corrupt state or the next corrupt state? No, leave our land alone, politicians. That is why your question on the royalty. BLF respects African royalty. Respect, in fact, part of going to your Africanness is the question of what was this system of rule which we had and what of which of it can be used to serve our interest. I don't subscribe to the idea that you can go back to pre-slavery Africa. Africa was developing, our development was interrupted by colonialism and by slavery before. By the way, all technological developments that you see today, all of them come from the African template. We are the originators of knowledge that today the West has stolen and the West is using and claiming that it belongs to them. No, all this stuff is ours. And we must reclaim it back and use it in our interest. African, in fact, BLF is arguing that Parliament must have another house. And I'm telling you something that we are still discussing. There must be three houses. There must be a house of African royalty. Well, contra lesser and them, but we must sort a lot of things about also how our kings and chiefs operate. Half of the time, it is easy for them to take our land, give it to white people, take a little bit of money, and then rebona the company, delete the miner on our communities, resa iti horeyang, and a luruna resa kray benefit. So our kings, our chiefs, must have a system that puts the people first. Kosi ki kosi kati cha. The kosi tete di tamayang, di tamafati di afamakua. We have to deal with them. But that does not mean we must do away with the African royalty. African royalty must be protected, must be developed, and it must bring back the notion of saving the people. I don't know. Bahai to Dubai. Dubai, come on, Guta Hotengaligoti. United Arab Emirates. Today in the world, the biggest modernist development is Dubai, and it's also what is the other country? I mean, the other city there, Abu Dhabi. Yeah, Qatar. But just look at the Emirates, the Arab United Emirates, where Dubai is and where the other city is. In the world, if you Google comrades, you see it is unbelievable. The development that from, by the way, it was a desert. Dubai was, and we are not talking long time ago, in the 70s, they started this program of development, which today surpasses even Japan. What happened there, and what is happening today, seven kings, Arab kings, got together and formed the United Arab Emirates. And they were lucky because they got this mineral, which is the oil. They had now put that oil together in a fund. And these kings, bon, akuna democracy nyana yama watu atikwa. The cause it on the busa. But the cause it the busa in such a way that every single citizen of these Emirates, they live well. They've been well taken care of by the wealth of the nation. So there's nothing that stops our kings. You know, Naka, I want to say, kings will eat. If another vision ends, I be saying, Mahosi among Aro. You know, Makwa Kausan, the following day tomorrow, they will solve all our problems because those kings are powerful. But our kings do not have a vision to decolonize and make sure that we, the people, benefit. That is why we must engage them. Yeah. But you know what, comrades? Even the politicians are hungry. And it is stupid because South Africa has enough wealth to take care of all of us. Nobody should be hungry, including the kings and so on. The point I'm making, comrades, is to say we must engage our African royalty better. We must give them the respect they deserve, but we must make sure they serve our interest. We can't have a system which is just serving their interest. Then there were questions relating to, I'm very happy about the native, is that the native, landless native organization. The guy who spoke about the native is gone. But I mean, I'll be very happy to hear a little more about how that organization operates because we must all unite ourselves. Then there was a question about, I speak too much English, am I half black? No, but I mean, I'm under the impression that you are at an university and there's many people speak different languages and so on. No, but I mean, also those questions are a little bit silly, right? Because the person stands up, what are the ducks of London? And then he says, but yeah, you speak English, no. No, I think let's elevate the discourse. Let's elevate the discussion. Me speaking English to you does not mean that I admit to the English ways. I mean, it's like, I mean, I'm on Facebook. It is owned by an American. Does it mean that, therefore, I defer to American imperialism? I'm using Twitter. It owns, again, by Americans. And so please, let's not be petty on these questions. The for instance, you know, Setswana and Zulu are the two most developed languages of black people in this country. Technically, Setswana and Zulu. No. Allow me to make this point. Setswana and Zulu are the most developed technically. That's why the newspapers of Setswana and Zulu are amongst the biggest, right? But you know who developed these languages? It's Mangope here, and it is Matanzima on the other side. Now, Mangope worked within the white system, but he was able to develop Setswana. So you have to think very critically about language. The fact that I speak isiXhosa does not mean I am pro-black. In fact, that white man of the DA, Trolley, he speaks Xhosa. Does this fact of speaking Xhosa make him pro-black? No. So the language use itself needs to be decolonized so that it is clear about what interests it expresses. So we must beat English until it speaks black. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Make English scream black. And I mean, people like Bolise Khoram Pulikeng, I don't know that poet. Some of you, I mean, Lise Khoram Pulikeng is a very beautiful poet. And the way he uses language, the English language, he contorts it, he tortures it, and makes it speak black. And if you listen to him, you can hear the English language screams I am sorry, black people, through how he uses it. So let us decolonize all the instruments available to us. Now then there was an issue. Comrade, let's not talk. I left EFF. I did not leave EFF. EFF left me. They expelled me. And then, you know, that it goes. So, I mean, again, that's not an important issue. Then there is the Japan. Comrades, the Japanese example, I don't think it's a... Japan's land question is resolved, in fact, by Americans in a very strange thing. Because Americans were afraid of the Maoist communist revolution, which was coming into Japan. And by the way, they expropriated in Japan 1945. I know that story. They expropriated land in Japan. That's what they did. Expropriate land and distribute it to the poor and the landless peasants. That's how Japan actually, in fact, technological development of Japan is based on radical redistribution of land, incidentally by Americans, because they were afraid of communism, which was coming into Japan. Similarly with Taiwan. Go to look at the Taiwanese land redistribution program. It was a radical land redistribution program. Actually, they took land from big land owners and gave it. China, people talk about China. You can't be like China until you solve the land question. In China, they took land. They expropriated land. And on the basis of a rural accumulation of capital, you are able to develop the economy even further. So let us, I think those are good examples, in fact, we should look at. There is an issue of the Freedom Charter. Yeah, the Freedom Charter, comrade, and it's also earlier constitution. Both the Freedom Charter and the Constitution were written by white people, full stop. Both the Constitution and the Freedom Charter were written by white people. Comrades, we support Zuma for two reasons. Firstly, because Zuma is under attack from white people. There's no doubt about that. Secondly, yes, we criticized Zuma when he was president. I wrote an essay about it. But you know, when Zuma towards the end starts saying radical economic transformation, we had to pause and to say, what is this man saying? And then when we saw his program on the HIV and AIDS thing also, he raised our life expectancy by about, I think, 29%. Because, you know, they get these funny ideas around this issue. But then Zuma also dropped the bombshell when he gave us the free education. He said, let's have this thing. A lot of people saying, no, you must plan, no, you must, and there was that commission. That commission said, we must not get free education. The government must give guarantees to banks. Bank must loan us money. You see what they're doing. So now if you can't pay, government will pay the bank will make money, and then you must still pay that loan. Zuma said no loan, free education. Of course we know that free education has been taken away by the Ramaphosa Project, because a lot of students who are supposed to get free education struggle to get that free education. You still have to run through many ways, and some of you don't still get that money. Zuma simply said, look, get these people free education, go get, find the money. Plain Zimande was resisting. Of course, Pravin Gordhan also was resisting, and now they are in power. That is why they're still resisting to provide free education. But for us, as BLF, we're more attracted to the BRICS project. How we are saying, let's move to BRICS, let's move away from the West. And we also were frightened by what happened in Brazil. They removed the president using opposition parties, using the media and so on. And we said, Zuma is put in the same position. Why don't we push Zuma further and further to a radical project of radical economy transformation? Put content into that. Tell him, Zuma, we said land expropriation without compensation. Zuma is the only sitting president who came out and said land expropriation without compensation. He went further. He didn't just stop there. He said the mining charter. They removed that mining charter office. I hope you know. In that mining charter, Zuma said you must get 30% of the mineral rights in 12 months. 12 months, he said. And then if you look at women representation in the board, 70% of the procurement must happen from amongst black people. Very progressive stuff. So, of course, they removed him. So we support Zuma because he was attacked by white people, but we support him also because we think the radical economic transformation project, all of us, I don't understand why can't all of us support RET. And just give it radical content. The unfortunate thing is this. Comrade, yeah, talk about groupers. The unfortunate thing is this, that Comrade Ramaphosa will not touch the program of radical economy transformation because he is part of white monopoly capital. Yes. So there's no way it's going to expropriate white people. There's no way it's going to give us a reserve bank that belongs to the state. There's no way it's going to have a state bank. There's no way it's going to expropriate land because already white monopoly capital are his friends. This is the difficulty of the ANC. They have policy. They have now resolutions of a Congress and leadership which is anti those resolutions. That is why we as BLF said we will take our radical economic transformation, invite other people who want change, progressives, let us give content to this thing and let us defend it. The brother said the Guptas took, you said 100 billion. Yeah, comrade, you know what? There is a commission called the Zondo Commission. It's a commission, a judicial commission of inquiry. That commission wants corruption and evidence. If you have evidence of the 100 billion, comrades, BLF says, okay, comrades, BLF says Pravin Gordhan is corrupt. We say so. We are going to the commission to give the commission evidence that Pravin is corrupt. We don't make wild claims echoing what the media is saying. When the commission calls you for evidence, you are not there. We are going. If you have that evidence, we will support you, comrade. We will go with you to the commission to say, commission, investigate this. They hooked us a banner away with 100 billion rand. What we do know, as a matter of fact, is that Marcos Joste has disappeared just now, 20 billion rand from the PIC money. Why is he on holiday? He's not being changed. Why is he not in chains? Must we give more example of white people involved in corruption and nobody's touching them? And we're all talking about, you know why white people hate the Guptas? The Guptas are the only non-white group that entered the economy aggressively. So the white people don't, they are teaching them a lesson. That's why they made it. They gave some black people money here to actually attack the Guptas. Because white people felt uncomfortable with how the Guptas were entering the economy. But even then, comrade, look at ESCO, where it is claimed that they're involved in estate capture. They don't even, their business did not even constitute 5% of ESCO. Who is 95% doing business with ESCO? You never ask that question because it is Johan Rupert and the Oppenheimers. You know, comrades, it is shocking. We are all very unhappy when the Guptas landed at Waterkloof, right? It was bad, comrades. That is, you, but you know what? As we speak, me and you now, the Oppenheimer family have a private international airport inside O.R. Tambo. Now listen to this. Private, they have their own Akirakunale International Airport. Ya both house flyer going to Banalea Bona special. Where they land with their aeroplane is an international. Now I want you to think a little bit. It means they can fly from Kimberley with our diamonds into their airport, clear themselves, fly out to Colombia, drop those diamonds there, take cocaine, take guns, fly back, go fly to the DRC, go give our brothers their guns, get coltan, get other minerals in their own airplane, fly back to South Africa, fly to some other country and basically run a proper mafia project, which we, as this government of the ANC, have allowed the Oppenheimers. You are, yes, it's wrong for the Guptas to land at Waterkloof, but you give the Oppenheimers a whole international airport of their own and you don't say one word. There is a problem. Because you see, the discourse of corruption is controlled by white people. They decide who's corrupt and who's not corrupt. You know me, I think, I say, if the Guptas are fighting white monopoly capital, they become my strategic ally. My problem in South Africa is white monopoly capital. And if anyone is fighting white monopoly capital, that person becomes my ally. How to go to him? The enemy of my enemy? So if you can give me evidence that the Guptas are fighting white monopoly capital, from that day the Guptas are my friends. Because my big problem is not the Guptas are small fry. Atul kimaman. Atul rekamu fall. Atul talk one. King musi nyawe. But you can't do that to Oppenheimer. I mean, comrades, you know when President Zuma removed Nene, that 2015. In 2 days, I hope you know, Jorge, actually, the South Africa lost 500 billion rand in two days. Makua Abacha, Bona Bo Oppenheimer, Libo Maria Ramos, all the big capitalists. You know, they sat the ANC down and told them, you will fire Van Rooyen. You say the Guptas are appointing ministers. Well, they're failing because all these ministers says they were bribing me and I refused. We know for a fact that white capital appoints ministers. They told Zuma, if you don't fire this minister we don't want, we'll destroy the South African economy. Two down the line, Zuma looking at the JSE, he sees the country has lost 500 billion. And these people are saying, if you don't fire this one man, we will destroy this economy. What did Zuma do? He had to fire, Van Rooyen. And bring in who? Pravin, who was pre-approved by white people. So, let's deal with the real problem. Now, this brother made a big intervention about this issue of my brother. I thought I was clear when I made the analogy of Marx and Lenin. And in any event, I read Marx and Lenin. In fact, Marx is one of the best theoreticians on the question of capital. Of course, he's not a theoretician on the black question. That is why we follow Biko, we follow Fanon. Lenin is the best revolution, one of the best revolutionaries of the last century. He made a revolution. He changed the society. Che Guevara, similarly. We want to learn from those revolutionaries. It does not mean that we are slaves. That is why we follow people, but the idea that, Marx and so on. I criticize Marx. I've written a critique of Marx and Marxism and how it is colonial. But there are some things I take from Marx which I find useful. I think, comrades, man, the land expropriation without compensation, don't say that, rather say repossession. For me, it is a semantic program. People are saying, for instance, don't talk about land expropriation without compensation. Talk about repossession. They don't have a program of repossession. We are part of the discourse of land expropriation without compensation, criticizing it inside, pushing it further, organizing ourselves to actually repossess the land. So it is not that I don't think we must spend so much time talking. It's just been clever. Some people are too clever, I think. Too clever for our own good. What is the substance of land expropriation without compensation? You have to at least provide that critique to say it is doesn't go enough, it undermines our project, then I will listen. Right now, land expropriation without compensation provides the best platform to unite all of us to take land. But now what we must do is to push the ANC and EFF, expose them, push them further because they are in the system, to show that they are not serious. But at the same time, we organize ourselves to take back the land. I don't think I'm going to change the language and say, don't say land expropriation without compensation. Comrades, when you expropriate somebody without compensation, what does it mean? It means I'm taking and I'm not paying back because it belongs to me. For me, I heard the PAC comrades also say we need a disturb. I think people are too smart and they read too many texts, I think sometimes. It is good to read and we must read and we must study, but we must never get trapped in the abstractions of the formulation of the problem. You know, a lot of our people, for instance, who study Egyptology, they spent 30 years studying Egyptology, not organized one confrontation with the system. No, comrades, it is not knowledge which is the problem, or the mind. The mind was only taken after the land was taken. And the land was taken because they were better armed. And they were more evil than we are. And once they created a new system, the mind started adapting itself to their system. There's nothing wrong with, this is the problem. Africans were too advanced. War was not the thing that we involved in. We build a pyramid. I hope you all know the pyramids are a mystery. People who build the pyramids have reached the highest possible level of knowledge. White people call it a mystery. Runa, we just made that thing. Because that's how far we were. So I just think it's not discourse. I want people who talk about discourse, I want to see them organizing resistance. Actual resistance. Because some of us are organizing. We have been through a 2-year trial ourselves as leaders of BLF. We always confront. We're always testing. Other people are sitting and thinking big. I get frustrated. I say there's somebody who have absolute great respect for theoretical knowledge. It's important. But I think people theorize to avoid acting. Once you do that, you're not useful to us. There's a whole discourse now in America of very smart people, Afro-pessimists. I'm an Afro-pessimist myself initially, but now people are theorizing such that they do nothing. No, you are a politician. Politics will take you nowhere. But what are you doing then? Okay, fine. I also don't like politicians. They are bad. What are you doing to organize a resistance? They don't do anything. Comrade, somebody asked the question, and I'll stop there. Somebody, by the way, the issue of Africa. Who named this continent Africa? Well, this is a very interesting proposition. When we say we go back to Africa, which Africa are we going back to? I'm more existentialist, like Biko. We take what is good from the past. We imagine what is good for us today to serve the interests of our people moving forward, because we have never stopped thinking and we have never stopped creating. So it's not a question of going to pre-colonial, pre-slavery Africa. It does not exist. And often I think the path back to pre-colonial, pre-slavery Africa is already colonial. So we must, God has given us brains. We can recall some things of our past, of our ancestors, some of the best things that our ancestors have done. We must improve on those. You know, comrade, for instance, today, anything we call African here is permitted by whites. If whites thought that African practice was inimical to their interests, they would stop it. Here in this area, there's a thing called Kafri Skole. You know Kafri Skole, right? Bukhwera. Now, when you take the boys to the mountain, but no, comrade, it is our practice, it's a good practice that we had. No, wait. But it has been corrupted by whiteness, and they're permitting it for particular reasons. So you must be careful what they permit. They have killed how we pray. We no longer remember how we pray to God. Oh God, because there was something about that. They tamed us that Christianity. But me, I'm not anti-Christian. I say, take Jesus Christ, make him or her black, give him the strepu or sepadi, give him or her the sword, put him out to deal with the evil ones. Who are the evil ones? The evil ones are those who stole your land and oppressed your people. Pray to God to strengthen us. You comrades, Bushiri takes the Bible to make money. We are failing to take the Bible to make a revolution. Our people are already Christian. 90% of our people are Christian. You big Africans, what you do? You attack our people. Christianity is bad. This Jesus Christ, you are alienating our people. Our people, we need to work with Christianity. Blacken it, decolonize it, make it a weapon of liberation. You know, comrades, why our people are in churches? When you take everything from a people, everything like us, all you have is a religion that was being given to you by them. But that is the only thing you have. I do not have the heart to take away this one thing they have. Even if I have my question marks about them. I say, I'm going to go to church. And I say to the pastor, does God love the fact that our people are oppressed? Is it God's will that he give us land, he give us gold, he give us wealth? These people come here, they take it. Is it God's will? Pastor says no. I say, now, pastor, how come you don't preach about the main evil, which is the dispossession of our people, but these evil people that come from Europe? I say, pastor, let us pray. Let us pray to our God, the God that we have turned away from, the God that has been at war with the God of these guys, and we have allowed these guys to win because we have forgotten that there is a fighting God, and that is our God. And in fact, you can read in the Bible, the number of passages that will support your project of reclaiming back the land. Do not, comrades, it is a big mistake to simply dump Christianity, because who will then administer to their spiritual needs in ways which make our people even further enslaved. So, I'm going to go to the prophet Steve Biko, and then we sing, we talk about Christian. He's our prophet. God gave us Christian. Why would you say God gave us Christian? So, comrades, all I'm saying is we are at a time when we must use everything at our disposal to fight this battle. Let us not alienate the majority of our people to, you know, this instant radicalism. And some of these people are radical today. Baba Kimarom again. About decolonization about couple of Roma go to. After 5 years, I go get again Roma Kiyo Muto Dutimo. Marcodi Facebook one or Hakabu Roma Marcio will happen, kill Roma Hape Mutu. So I'm just saying, even Kobo Romengo, what stops us from saying Jesus Christ won't change? I can't see that being a big problem. I'm not a politician, comrade. Let me conclude there. Comrade, and I know that you are going to take some questions, but I beg you not to. I'm not a politician, I'm a revolutionary. I hate politicians. I think politicians basically are liars. And what we must do, just like I was talking about the church, I'm trying to use politics to end politics. You see? Yeah, no. You can say that, but for instance, when we joined EFF, we said we are Sankara. We said, and we'll do it, we said, we as people going to parliament, we must not use private healthcare. We must not even send our children to private schools. And there were about four things that we agreed on. We announced those things. After election, 2 days later, we're preparing to go to parliament. I was the only person who stood up in a meeting and said, we have made a commitment. We have said we'll not use these things. What are we saying about that now? There was a clear response. Commissar, do you want us to die in those hospitals? You see, we lie to our people so quickly. If it is not us who must die in the hospital, who must die in those hospitals? It is a very easy program, man, comrades. All people who are elected must use public services by law. The president must use public services. The director general must use public services. You know, question me, there's no medicine there. Because politicians go to the private hospitals. If we say by law, you and your family must use public services, do you realize how quickly the quality of the service will go up? Just like schools, we abandon those schools. So we brought that idea of Sankara. It was agreed, we went to our people and said we'll do it. But politicians, as soon as they got elected, they said, no, they're not going to do that. And nobody raised that issue. No, comrades, politicians are bad. We must be revolutionaries. And then we must be held accountable to the things that we say we do. That's why we must not have a long list of things. We must have a few things that we commit ourselves to and must be held accountable to those. Party, my politicians, party! Party!